from WBBZ-TV Sports. It's time to beat the champ. Now, here are your hosts, Paul Peck and Sue Nowoitzki.
Well, hi, everybody, and welcome to Beat the Champ with Sue and Janelle. My name is Paul Peck, and welcome back to the Mancuso Bowling Center here in Batavia. It's our second week here in Genesee County. We had a great first week, Sue. We had Rich Wagner, the hometown guy, rattle off a couple of wins, and then one of the true pros in Western New York, Pat Brick, gets the victory. He comes back. His opponents, potentially today, are all guys who have bowled on this show before.
Yes, so we have some experience here, so it's going to come down to execution and shot making, and whoever does that the best is going to have the best week.
On the lineup here today, Jeff Pohlman, Chuck Jagodzinski, and Danielewicz. That means, Janelle, some more high scores and some more good crowds.
Definitely. We had a great crowd last week. We hope we can keep up that energy and that noise level. It was amazing.
Yeah, it was. It was great here. We'll see if it happens again. Week number two here in Batavia. First match is Pat Brick and Jeff Pohlman. So let's get rolling. It's Jeff Pohlman making his second appearance on Beat the Champ. Pat Brick making his fifth appearance. It is the second month in a row that we'll get a chance to see Jeff Pohlman. He made his Beat the Champ debut last month at the Rapids Bowling Center. Wound up losing to eventual winner Chris Labiak, but Jeff's got his game going in the right direction, and he's back qualified here in the fourth spot, and he will be the challenger to Pat Brick.
Yeah, that's no easy feat to make the show 2 months in a row.
It is not. That hasn't happened all that much. So the 43-year-old from Clarence Center with his first throw leaves the four pins standing up. So a chance for a spare here for Jeff Pohlman, financial advisor at AXA Advisors in Williamsville, New York. 225 overall average for Jeff. He has been bowling since he's 8 years old. Like us on the Facebook page for Beat the Champ. Follow us on social media at Beat the Champ TV and hashtag Beat the Champ for all the latest information on qualifying and results. So here's Jeff trying to finish off this first frame spare. And he's got it. So that gives us our first look of the day at Pat Brick making his fifth Beat the Champ show appearance, an overall record of 4 wins and 2 losses, and the trophy that he took home last week for his victory over Rich Wagner, the second time, Sue, you have presented the big hardware to Mr. Brick.
Yeah, Pat's a very talented bowler. Like you said in the introduction, this is going to be come down to execution for these two guys because they're both very solid bowlers. Don't make too many bad shots, and I expect to see some real strong bowling today.
First throw for Pat is a strike. A 239 to 223 win over Rich Wagner in our last match of last week's show elevated Pat Brick onto the appearance here today. 49-year-old from Tonawanda, New York, a pharmacy technician and a Hall of Famer, crowned a couple of weeks ago right after Thanksgiving at the induction ceremonies. That an emotional speech for Pat Brick as he entered the Greater Buffalo USBC Hall of Fame. And speaking of the Greater Buffalo USBC and the USBC as a whole, I'm going to introduce you to our special guest as soon as Pat throws here in the first frame, second frame actually, and just didn't get enough turn on that one, so he'll leave the 6 and 10 up on the right-hand side.
That's just the result of missing a little tiny bit to the left, a little high hit, couldn't trip out that 6-10.
So Pat Brick will try to pull off the spare here in frame number two. And he gets it. So we want to welcome in our special guest. We're here in Batavia, so we had to bring a good old Batavia guy in here to join us, but a Batavia bowler and a guy who's very involved in the sport. We welcome Mike Petnell, Association Manager for the USBC and a bowling columnist here for the Batavian. Mike, thanks for coming in and talking a little bowling with us.
Well, thank you, Paul and Sue. It's a pleasure to be here. I want to congratulate you both on the show. It's a tremendous bowling, and we wish you continued success.
Good strike for Jeff Pohlman in the second frame. Thank you very much, Mike. What's been the reaction to the bowling community here in Batavia having us? We had a great turnout for our first show. We had the local bowler, Rich Wagner, bowled really well, but it seems like the Batavia bowling folks are excited to have us.
Well, definitely. This is something that is really great for bowling, and we had Rich Wagner, like you said, did a very, very nice job last week. And we got Fred Gravanda coming up in a future show. And just got a lot of great bowling in Batavia, right in between Buffalo and Rochester, and it's a really hot spot for bowling.
Yeah, we'll have Fred on our next week's show, and that's one of the nice things about moving this show around is when you get to a place like Batavia, you get some of the Batavia folks that want to come out and try to make the show, and in this case, we got two of them that did. Right. So that just adds to a little bit of the local flavor.
Well, I was fortunate enough to be able to qualify the first round, but I fell a little short the second round, but that's okay. It's great to have the opportunity. To be involved.
We get it. You'd rather be out there than sitting next to us, right?
I get how that works. I can handle both roles. I appreciate it.
Here's Pat Brick. This is the third frame for Pat. Strike and a spare on the first two. And there's another strike for Pat Brick. Well, Mike, tell us a little bit about your role as association manager for the USBC, what that entails. And I know it means you're involved in the sport on a statewide basis, not just here in Western New York.
That's correct. About 5-6 years ago now, the state associations, there were three of them. There were the New York State men's, women's, and the youth. So there were three associations. We merged and became, at that time, the largest merged state association in the nation. Right now, I believe we're the second largest. But we have about 95,000 bowlers that are certified through the United States Bowling Congress, which are the headquarters in Arlington, Texas. Of those 95,000, about 10,000 are youth bowlers. Our numbers are doing pretty well. Overall, there's been a general decline in organized bowling over the last 15 years, as you, I'm sure you know. But New York State is doing very well, and we have a lot to offer our members, and we're very proactive in trying to keep our association strong.
You saw Pat Brick with a strike in the fourth, so that's three of the first four. And Jeff Pohlman looking for a third strike in a row and instead is going to leave a little bit of an ugly 4-7-10 split here. So.
Yeah, that ball just hooked up a little high on him. I think it looked like a good shot off his hand. Lanes might be changing a little bit. We've seen a little bit more bowling on the right than in the last few matches. So lanes will change a little bit for them.
So let's see what Jeff can do with this one here in the fourth frame. And he's going to grab the two, the four, and the seven, and leave the 10. So it's an open frame in the fourth for Jeff Pohlman.
This feels like a good time to take a short break. We'll be right back with more action on Beat the Champ. Welcome back to Beat the Champ. Let's get back to the action here on WBBZ-TV.
I'm with Jeff Pohlman, our first contestant, taking on Pat Brick today. What do you think about bowling a left-hander on these late conditions?
I'm kind of excited, actually, to have the right side to myself. The last three shows have been lefties, so looking forward to opening the lane up for myself. Pat was just inducted in the Hall of Fame, so it's going to be a great opportunity to bowl against one of the elite bowlers in our area.
It's a little bit of a struggle out there.
Yep. So now Pat Brick, coming off of his open frame in the sixth, really does have a chance to try to make a run here and put this one away.
I expect him to make a couple good shots here.
Yeah, that's what Pat Brick does. Nice, smooth approach and good results. Seventh frame strike for Pat, who bowls on Monday nights at Classic Lanes with his wife in a doubles league. And then Wednesday nights at Spare Time Lanes, almost 70. He's lost track of how many 300 career games he's had, Pat. Somewhere around 70 and somewhere around 30 to 4,800 series in the career of Pat Brick and Hall of Fame career, as we mentioned before, for the Tonawanda native.
He bowls a lot of tournaments. And Mike, I'm sure you've seen his name pop up all over the place.
He's at the state tournaments every year. He's at the local tournaments. He's just a great bowler. And there's a couple good shots that we talked about.
Yeah, two strikes in a row now for Pat Brick.
He kind of sensed it, and he just jumped on the opportunity.
Yeah, well, and Sue talks, and you talk a lot about that. When your other bowler is struggling, you see the chance to jump in and take advantage of it, and that's what good bowlers do.
And we've seen Pat be very strong at that. I'm guessing that he's struck every time that his opponent is open because he knows how to jump on those opportunities.
In the match against Wagner, he saw an opportunity, he struck out and closed that out.
Right.
And there's the nicest, one of the nicer throws of the day for Jeff Pohlman. A nice strike here in the eighth frame. We'll have to see if it's going to be enough and if Pat starts to falter or not. But the three open frames for Jeff Pohlman are kind of hanging over his head right now.
Well, he does have a chance to at least make Pat show up if he can produce here in the last couple of frames.
Right. He's going to have to go off the sheet, which is striking all the rest of his shots for a 200. He can go off the sheet for 202.
So let's see what Jeff can do here in the ninth frame. Looked good from the start, and he gets a good result, so he keeps hanging in there right now, putting the pressure on Pat Brick. Next up for the winner of this match is Chuck Jagodzinski, waiting in the wings to take over. So you also stay busy writing for the Batavian here, and you write a lot about bowling. So what are the big bowling stories that are sort of floating out there right now?
Well, I've been writing a bowling column for going on 40 years. I want to date myself, but I started with the Batavia Daily News back in the late 70s and worked there for many years. Another strike for Pat.
Yep.
But, and so it's been able to continue the bowling column throughout the years, whether it was in the Batavia Daily or in other publications. Right now it's in the Batavian, which is the region's number one source for online news. We have a bi-weekly column that very well received. We have sponsors. We have about 15 different businesses that sponsor the page. It's called Pinpoints, and you could go to thebatavian.com to see that. And we're right. This was a big story here for the last few weeks, being Beat the Champ in town and in the qualifiers.
Don't forget, at the end of our show here, towards our third match, we'll have the Modern Windows Word of the Week. You can win $5,000 worth of new windows, complete with installation from Modern Windows. Another strike for Pat Brick as he starts the 10th frame here, and that's going to get him the victory in this match. So, well, good. We're excited that Beat the Champ gave you some material to write about there. And, and I know you interviewed both of us before we got started today. We appreciate that very much. But
we're going to do a story on you guys being here, and looking forward to writing that.
And Pat's on a roll here to wrap this thing up. So
That's sealing the deal right there.
Sealing the deal. There you go. That, well said. So, but, yeah, that's, I think, one of the fun parts about it. For us and for this show is you come to a community like Batavia and they're excited to have us and the bowlers turn out and they want to be a part of it and they're figuring out how to get off of work to be here to watch the taping and make sure they're in it and qualifying. That's what's been an awful lot of fun. So wherever it is that we may be going. So Pat Brick posts up a solid 241 score on the board, and that's going to be enough to advance Pat to his second consecutive win and a battle with Chuck Jagodzinski to come in our second match of the day. Jeff Pohlman will finish things out here in the 10th frame. Nice strike for him right there.
That'd be nice to see Jeff pull out a 200 game here. You know, he's coming back from those early struggles he had.
Yeah, and Jeff and I have the pleasure of working together, and we talk a lot about bowling, and I sensed his frustration that he'd been trying to qualify and couldn't make the shows, and then now he's made two shows in a row and hasn't bowled the way that he knows he wants to bowl and he knows he can bowl.
Yeah, he definitely got caught in a little transition out there because he's got the line back again. He started off hitting the pocket great and then, just broke down a bit for him in the middle of the game, sort of caused the whole problem for him. He picked it right back up again.
Yeah, Jeff's an outstanding bowler, part of the Buffalo City Tournament Scratch Team Champions here in 2016, and we've seen him two months in a row, and a pretty good chance we might see him again if we'll see if we can't get him off of work to get down there to Jamestown to make the show down there next month. I'll try to pull some strings for him over there with Lou and the guys and Jack over at AXA. So Jeff Pohlman posts up a 201. He gets to that 201 like you wanted to see, Mike.
That's really
but it's a 241-201 win for Pat Brick over Jeff Pohlman. So Pat Brick moves on. We'll talk to Jeff about how this match went down. When we return, our first match is in the books here at the Mancuso Bowling Center in Batavia, New York. Much more to come on Beat the Champ.
Hey,
It's a 241 to 201 win for Pat Brick over Jeff Pohlman. That middle of the match, those open frames kind of killed you. What did you lose it a little bit there, Jeff? What happened?
Yeah, I got ahead of the three shots in a row, and you can't miss here early, inside. You got a little play outside your line, but, you're bowling against a Hall of Fame bowler, and you start squeezing a little bit right in the middle there, and I knew I was up against a big game, and it worked out at the end. It smoothed out a little bit, but you can't open against some of the best.
Like you said, you kind of know when you're going against somebody like Pat Brick that you can't leave him the openings like
that's
that.
Absolutely. Yep, that's right. How it goes.
So Pat Brick takes advantage. He moves on. It's Pat Brick and Chuck Jagodzinski in our next match. We're back here in Batavia right after this on Beat the Champ.
I'm here with Chuck Jagodzinski. He's here to take on one of the winners of Beat the Champ. What, how's it feel to be back?
It feels good. We'll see how I bowl. Like in qualifying, about a 181 and a 279 both qualifiers. So hopefully my 279s will come out today.
Well, you're one of our more outstanding winners. When you start bowling, when you start winning, you keep winning. So what's your strategy for today on the lanes? We've seen a lot of left-handed bowlers.
Well, my shot won't be broken down, so I'll probably very right, and hopefully Jeff will break it down a little for me.
A couple of real heavyweights going at it in this match. Pat Brick and Chuck Jagodzinski, our second match of the day here at the Mancuso Bowling Center in Batavia, New York, our second week here in Batavia. And Chuck Jagodzinski, one of the most successful of all the Beat the Champ bowlers. This is his seventh show appearance. 8 wins, only 3 losses. He's taken home 3 weekly trophy wins. But we haven't seen him in a couple of months since Grand Island, so it's good to have Chuck back on the show and good to see what we normally see, which is strikes from Chuck Jagodzinski. What makes him one of the best bowlers in Western New York?
Consistency, absolutely. Consistency and bowling smarts, that's what you're gonna see out of both these guys, really, because they have a rich history of 300s and 800s, and they know how to strike.
So you talk about two of the more consistent bowlers anywhere in Western New York. This should be a match for the ages between Pat and Chuck. And right off the bat, we've got the early preview of that with strikes in both frames for these two guys.
Well, there may not be a strategy in bowling. You can't control what your opponent does, but you have to be very smart to be a good bowler. You have to read things before they happen. You have to anticipate what's happening with the oil pattern, because you can't see your obstacles. They're invisible on the lane. So these guys are very, very crafty.
Now here's a question for both of you, Sue, and for Mike, and for you, Mike Petinella. Do you have to know your opponent? Do you have to feel like I know I'm bowling against Chuck. Chuck knows he's bowling against Pat. Great bowler. I mean, do you have to go into a match going, okay, I have a feeling what I'm going to get out of this guy. What do I need to do to beat him?
Well, I think for Chuck, seeing how Pat is hitting the pocket consistently, he's probably feels that he's going to have to match fire with fire. So, Pat's going to strike a lot. So right off the bat, I think he's probably in his mind, I'm going to have to throw a lot of strikes to win this match. So that could affect him psychologically. But I think the key for Chuck is to try to keep the speed up so that he's keeps the ball online.
How about you? Did you go into matches knowing who you were bowling against?
From time to time, you can slow bowl somebody or you can rush somebody. That's probably the only thing you really have the advantage to do. Some people like to bowl fast, and you'll know who they are from seeing them a lot. Or if you slow bowl them and jiggle around a little bit or re-rack, sometimes they'll re-rack to slow the match down. Let the other person sit there for a little longer. Because your hand will blow up a little bit if you let them sit too long. So I'd say that might be the only defense in bowling.
That's probably about the extent of it, really.
But how about mentally? Aside from some of those tactics, which are absolutely, mentally, these two guys have bowled against each other hundreds of times. They both know how good each of them are. Do you go into a match like this thinking, that's Pat Brick over there, I better match him up?
I don't think so much that, other than the fact that you want to be at the top of your game. You're going to need a lot of strikes because he's not missing the pocket much. Well, so Pat, I think it's just the performance aspect of what Pat has been showing may get into your mind a little bit.
Pat's not missing anything yet, as I was going to say. Mike, that strikes in the first three frames for Pat. Chuck struck in the first and then left the 10 pin in both the second and the third. So right now, Pat's got the early advantage, does the 49-year-old from Tonawanda with the 220 overall average and a litany of titles throughout his career. Tonawanda City Tournament, Buffalo City Tournament, all events, New York State titles, Obenauer Masters, you name it, Pat Brick has pretty much won it.
You know what You know what you will see from time to time, and that is someone that doesn't watch the other person bowl, because you don't want a Brooklyn strike or a lucky strike, or you don't want any of that to play into your thought process. So oftentimes people won't even watch. Pat's not really paying a whole lot of attention to what's happening out there.
Because you have no control over it, right? So there's no sense getting yourself too worked up about it. So I understand that. I get that. Well, Mike, one of the things in your role as the association manager for the New York State USBC is certainly promoting the sport, but give people an idea of why it's important for them to be a part of the USBC.
Yeah, we just got a double from Chuck, so he's staying alive. But yes, it's people get the there's the perception out there that they don't get a lot for their USBC membership, and I really believe that you get more than meets the eye. It's only at the most a $21 fee for the whole year, and if you look at other sports, especially youth sports, you're paying hundreds of dollars a year to participate in these sports. Where bowling, they ask you for anywhere from an $18 to $21 fee to participate.
Pat Brick will leave the 7-pin up in the fifth frame, ending his run of four consecutive strikes to open up the match here.
But continuing on, so you pay a one-time fee, and that gets you, you know, even though you don't get the awards that you might have got from the USBC at one time, about 2.5 years ago, the USBC discontinued its awards program. Spare for Pat. Mm-hmm. So they discontinued it because the membership has declined from the heyday of bowling from about 7 million members to about 2 million now nationally. So they couldn't really afford to be giving out multiple awards for 300 games, 299s, 11 in a row, 700, 800s. So they shifted that responsibility onto the local associations. There's about 100 local associations in New York State. Mm-hmm. And just to talk about where we are here, you got the Greater Buffalo Association. Another corner pin.
Yep.
Greater Buffalo Association, which is does a very, very good job, one of the model associations really in the state. And where I live in Batavia is the Genesee Region USBC. They have both taken the responsibility upon themselves and have come up with their own awards programs to recognize bowlers not only for honor scores like 300 games, but also for achievements over their average. Let's say someone has a 175 average and they bowl a 250 game or a 200 game. Well, they're going to give them a little something just for that. And maybe it'll be a coaster. Maybe it'll be a mug. You know, they've got these different awards, and that is very important because people like to be recognized. No matter what level you're at in bowling, whether you're a kid just starting off or a senior at the limelight of your bowling career, everybody likes to be recognized. And so if the local association could take that and pick that up, it's going to make bowling a lot better and make people feel that they're getting something for their money.
That's three in a row now for Chuck Jagodzinski, looking for four in a row here in the seventh frame, and the 10-pin will hold up for him to prevent that from happening. But this is a good battle going on right now. These guys are going at each other.
Those corner pins don't care whether you're right-handed or left-handed. They always rear themselves at the worst time.
It's pretty much whoever carries is going to win this match. They're both in the pocket.
We're going to be back with more Beat the Champ bowling action in just a minute. Welcome back to Beat the Champ. Let's get back to the action here on WBBZ-TV.
So Pat's holding on to his 10-pin lead, hoping to strike here and build on that.
Nice, easy stroke.
It was a little wide, but it got it back.
Yep, and he got a couple of pins to fly around there and knock some of them down, so it's a strike for Pat Brick.
I feel like interjecting right here when you said what kind of psychs you out, or you know, the mental aspect between two competing bowlers. Pat just slapped that out. Little slap up there. That is one of the things that kind of drives your opponent absolutely crazy when someone slaps a shot out at you. I'll tell you, that they don't do it at the other person, so to speak, for a reason. They did it because they made a great shot and it was a critical time to make that shot. But I myself have always found that to be psych me out, that slap.
Interesting.
We haven't seen a lot of slapping out shots here on Beat the Champ, but that was awesome. That was very intense.
Well, Chuck caught a little break there with the six-pin leave, so he's definitely in the match.
Yeah, that keeps it close.
Spare
I shouldn't be telling my secrets on TV.
Well, no, hey, that's okay. That's all right.
Yeah, now when I'm in a match with somebody, they're going to slap it out at me every shot.
That's right. You just exposed your weak spot. Nice strike for Jagodzinski in the eighth.
Well, Sue's one of the top bowlers in the state. We've seen her excel at the state tournaments. 299 game a couple years ago in Albany. Always among the leaders in the all events and the doubles and singles. The team. So she's you've got a great bowler here sitting next to you.
Yeah, you're not gonna let any of that stuff bother you. You better not.
Jagodzinski. Big shot here.
Another strike for Chuck. You can kind of tell when he finds his rhythm.
Just tied the match up.
Great, awesome. Tied up going into the 10th frames here. Pat will have one in the ninth. And then this one's going to come down to the 10th frame. Ninth frame, Pat Brick. Tie match. Strike.
Wow, that was a great shot. There's that execution we're talking about. Needed that. Absolutely perfect shots.
10th frame's gonna decide it.
We love it when these 10th frames. We love it when they come down to the 10th frame. That's what bowling is all about. It's three guys, three balls to decide who's gonna win. Will it be Pat Brick's third win in a row, or will Chuck Jagodzinski get a chance to start a run of his own?
What do we do in the event of a tie?
We have a bowl off, right? A one throw bowl off, right? We have not had it happen yet.
It's one ball.
Oh. Strike for Pat Brick in the 10th. That has not happened yet. We've had two things that have not happened in a year of Beat the Champ. We have not had a bowl off on a tie, and we have not had a 300 game yet.
Well, if these guys strike out, you could have that tie. 248
See,
possibility.
That means we're going to have you hang around a lot more because, you're branching us into new areas here, Mike.
That would be something to see that.
Well, this brings up the strategy of whether you choose as the high qualifier to start the match or finish the match, because Pat has chosen to finish the match and put the pressure on Chuck to have to perform.
Oh!
Yeah, you could tell he knew it as soon as he threw it. And he pushed it too much to the right.
Well, I think the way it looks here is that Chuck needs a strike to win.
So Pat throws his final ball, and for Pat Brick, that will post up his final score of 235.
That wasn't the ideal count either, because this leaves Chuck striking. He needs striking eight.
So let's see if Chuck Jagodzinski can take advantage. And he does not get the strike. And you can see the reaction from Chuck Jagodzinski. It was right there in front of him, and he could not pull it off.
Pat Brick survives.
And a frustrating throw there, and the missed spare by Chuck Jagodzinski. So it's a 235 to 215 win. And as you said, Mike, Pat Brick survives in a match that was back and forth right down to the end. Two great bowlers put on a nice little show there,
didn't
they?
Yeah, that's exactly what we expected from those
Chuck
two.
Chuck made a great shot, too. He could see he was frustrated when he left that 10 pin. That was an excellent shot he made.
So Pat Brick gets his third win. He'll have a chance for the sweep. Next up for him, another match. John Danielewicz will be the next opponent. But when we come back here to the Mancuso Bowling Center in Batavia, we'll find out from Chuck what happened there in the end. We'll talk to him. We'll preview the next match. It is Beat the Champ in Genesee County at Mancuso Bowling Center in Batavia. We are back right after this.
Well, it comes right down to the 10th frame, and Chuck Jagodzinski unable to come up with what he needed to do to beat Pat Brick. So Brick moves on. You are frustrated as much as I can ever remember seeing you after any of these matches. Tell me why.
Every ball was flush in the pocket. You can't carry 60% and lose. You need better carry, and it is. Every time I let the time frame move right, then a frame or two later, I left another one, so it didn't matter what I did. But I needed a break, and I didn't get one.
All right. Do you enjoy going up against a guy like Pat? I mean, you two guys as a whole are two of the best bowlers in all of Western New York.
Yeah, and I put every ball flush in the pocket and went home with the loss.
Right. Well, it was a tough one for Chuck, and but we know we're going to see more of him. We know we got one more at least to see from Pat Brick. We'll have that match, our final one of the day here in Batavia, when we return on Beat the Champ.
I'm here with John Danielewicz. He's here to take on the winner of our last match. And he's also won once. What did you think of your Beat the Champ experience?
Oh, I loved it. Yeah, it was nice.
Yeah, so you're here to try to win your second title, and you're going to take on some great bowlers to do that. What's your strategy?
Just take my time and hit my target, that's all.
Okay, well, I guess that's the best we could do out here. So good luck to you, John.
Thank you very much.
Trying to prevent Pat Brick from winning his fourth in a row is 58-year-old John Danielewicz, making his second appearance here on Beat the Champ. We haven't seen him since sometime over the summer when we were up at Manor Lanes, and that's where John won one match and lost one match. So it's been a little while since he's been back, but it's good to have him back, and he's got his work cut out for him, taking on Pat Brick, who is hot. Three in a row for Pat, trying to come up with the sweep. And it's a strike on the first frame and the first throw for John Danielewicz.
Little love tap on the 10 pin there.
That's okay. They all count that way, right? Mike Pettinelli, Association Manager of the USBC, continues to join us here at Mancuso's Bowling Center here in Batavia. And now we get our first look at Pat Brick. One thing we get in consistency out of Pat, 239, 241, 235, Sue, in his three wins so far. And the 7-pin will stick, and Pat will have to go for the spare here on frame number one. So now Pat Brick goes from battling one of the greats in Chuck Jagodzinski to maybe a guy that he doesn't bowl very often. So back to our theme, a little bit of knowing who you're bowling and knowing how you mentally prepare for it. Does that have any effect on Pat Brick at all?
No, not at all. And Pat especially only bowls his own game. Like it's mentioned earlier, he doesn't really even watch. He is very intense on staying within himself, staying within his own game, and going up there and making good shots, which is why we're really just seeing him, you know, leave a corner pin here or there, which even your best shot will sometimes leave a corner pin.
Yeah, that is true. That is true. Well, Mike, tell us a little bit. You talked a little earlier in our last match about the benefits of being a part of the USBC, and I know you wanted to expand a little bit upon that.
Well, there are a number of member benefits that maybe people don't know about. When you join the USBC, they've partnered with many different businesses to provide different discounts. There's insurances, there's airline flights, there's restaurants. In Buffalo, I know they have a long list of restaurants and different businesses that they're affiliated with. You join and you get discounts by being a member. So it's like membership has its privileges, mm-hmm. so to speak. So that's another thing. The USBC is actually the national governing body of bowling. It's been sanctioned by the United States Olympic Committee. There is a push that someday we can get bowling in the Olympics. And by being a member, you're actually supporting that effort and being part of an organization with standardized rules, regulations, everything that's out there, the equipment, the lanes are all have to be inspected by USBC representatives. So it's more than just giving your money away. You're part of something that's actually greater than yourself.
little interesting spare here for John Danielewicz, and he pulls
split.
It off. Yeah, a little 3-10 baby split, and Danielewicz comes up with a nice spare here in the second frame. Well, of course, if you're a serious bowler, you should be part of the Bowling Association, aside from all the benefits that you get. It's, if you're serious about the sport, as we know so many people in Western New York are, it makes sense.
You know, plus you get a certified average, you can participate in tournaments at no extra cost other than the entry fee of the tournament. You don't have to be like pay another membership fee to bowl in tournaments. And nice strike for John.
Yep. And you really are protected because your league money becomes bonded.
That's another issue. Bonding. Now, bonding is that means your league funds are insured. Unfortunately, we've had instances where the money when you go to your banquet, and they put your food on the table, but where's your packet of your prize money for the year? And sometimes that people have unfortunately not misuse the prize funds. So through the USBC, you are bonded and you can recoup any losses to malfeasance.
Lots of spinning and flying pins on that third frame throw by Pat Brick, but he couldn't get one of them to spin over and knock the 10 pin down. So Pat will go for the spare here as John Danielewicz with two strikes in the first three frames is putting the pressure on Pat Brick. And a nice, easy third frame spare for the 49-year-old from Tonawanda, Pat Brick.
One thing about Pat Brick, though, you notice how on his spares, he's just right on. I mean, he's definitely a polished bowler. He's got all parts of the game are top-notch.
And that probably has a lot to do with all the success that he has. As you've always told me, you got to make those spares.
Well, when you bowl tournaments a lot, as he does, you go to a lot of different houses and you don't trust every single lane condition to make your spares. So bowlers on this level will get a plastic ball, spare ball, and they'll throw right at their spares, or they learn how to throw it really, really straight and really take the lane condition out of the, not a factor.
Yeah, that's something that, as I was growing up in bowling, we never had that even thought process. You get another ball for your spares, so you learn to try to hook the ball into your spares. The bowlers today, they just hard and straight, plastic ball right at the spares.
Right.
Like Sue said, take the lane out of it. All you want to do is knock it down. You don't get style points.
Right, and that's what we just saw Pat do. But we have seen plenty of other bowlers that don't do that, that do play their normal hook to get spares.
Well, your left-hand side spares, and I'm speaking as a right-hander, so it would be the opposite for Pat, obviously. Your left-hand spares, we learned, first lesson was the 369 rule.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're shooting, taking the head pin into account, if you're shooting the pin to the left of the head pin, which would be the two pin, you move your feet three boards and hit your strike target. To hit the four pin, you move your feet six boards and use your strike target. To make the seven pin, you move nine boards and use your strike target. So that's one of the fundamentals of bowling and making your left hand spares is the 369 rule.
Mm-hmm. So a little fist pump there from John Danielewicz as he pulls off the strike in the fourth frame. 58 years old from Sanborn, New York. He is retired. Only really picked up bowling a little later on in life. Has only been bowling for 20 years.
Bowling pretty
well.
Very nice ball. You got a nice, solid style.
Three in a row, 4 out of 5 for John Danielewicz.
The action will continue on Beat the Champ in just a minute. Welcome back to Beat the Champ.
And he won't be able to do that. Seven pin, a little sticky in the left corner for Pat Brick. And that may be what determines this match. So it was a crucial eighth frame that Pat Brick needed a strike and did not get it. And now things are a little easier. A little more room for error for John Danielewicz.
Absolutely.
Yeah, the most Pat could get, I believe, 205. John's on a 227
yes,
pace.
Yes, so John needs two marks out of the next three in order to seal this match.
So it'll be a spare opportunity in the eighth frame here for John. 200-300 career games for John Danielewicz, a high 789 series. Not sure what John would tell you is more exhilarating, jumping out of planes or winning on Beat the Champ and beating Pat Brick.
Well,
I can tell you that that's not going on the career highlights list right there. Open frame in the eighth for John Danielewicz, and now the pressure shifts back to him.
Well, he needs one mark, I believe, in the last two frames. See if he can get it.
Oh, he actually needs two marks.
Ninth frame. Got some nice pin action that gets him the strike.
The strike was good enough, right?
He's in now.
So that will clinch it. So it's going to be a victory for John Danielewicz to end the three-match winning streak of Pat Brick. And that prevents Pat from moving up into our top four of wins here on Beat the Champ. And that's only because it took Pat a couple of months to get to the show early in the year, but he's been pretty active and pretty steady over the last few months, so we expect that to continue. Don't forget, coming up shortly is our Modern Windows Word of the Week. You could win $5,000 worth of new windows, complete with installation from Modern Windows. Strike in the ninth frame for Pat Brick. Not going to be enough. Oh, maybe.
We'll see what he can do here. You never, anything can happen.
Maybe you get a look at the Castellone Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram scoreboard. You can see where we are headed into the 10th frame. So Pat Brick prepares the ball, cleans it off, eyes it up, lines himself up, and gets ready for the 10th frame. The lefty from Tonawanda with a big throw.
Great
and
shot.
A strike.
Great shot. Still has 205 left on the board. He can throw the next two, which will force John to have to make a spare.
Well, and in typical expected fashion, Pat's not going down without a fight, and he's going to put as much pressure as he can on his opponent. And that probably determines things right there.
Yeah, that's
six pin would not fall.
John wins.
So Pat will close things out here. He'll grab that six pin on the spare, or maybe not necessarily. And a shake of the hands for John Danielewicz. Pat Brick with a 193 on the board. And John Danielewicz will finish things out in the 10th frame for a victory. And for the first time, you will be handing the Beat the Champ trophy to John Danielewicz. And a good
nice
strike
shot.
There. Good, strong, powerful strike for John. Well, Mike, it's been a pleasure to have you on. We appreciate all the insight and all the knowledge, and best of luck with everything on the USBC front for you. We're looking forward to seeing the, I'm sure, what will be a glowing article about Sue. Me, maybe not so much, but about Sue and the Batavian. We thank you for that as well.
You'll be part of that too, Paul. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
But we've had a great time down here. This is a good bowling town, and we've had a wonderful time here. We've got two more weeks of it coming up after this week as well, too. So thank you for joining us for the last couple of shows.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure.
So one more for John Danielewicz to finish off and post his final score. It'll be a win for John, which means he gets to come back next week. And there's the spare and the final score up on the board for John Danielewicz. Comes up with a 224 to 193 victory. And we will talk to both bowlers, John and Pat, and wrap up our second week stop here at the Mancuso Bowling Center in Batavia. When we return, it is Beat the Champ. We are back right after this. It's John Danielewicz with a win over Pat Brick here in our final match of week number two in Batavia. Well, I guess it's how bowling goes, Pat. You eke out a narrow one over Chuck in the match before in the 10th frame, and here you get a chance going into this 10th, and it doesn't go the way that you want it to.
That's exactly right. That's part of the fun of the bowling. Sometimes you win when maybe you shouldn't. Sometimes you lose when maybe you could have won, but John bowled a good game. I had some carry issues. I threw a terrible shot in the middle of the game. So, you know, when it came down to it, he made the shots that he had to, and he won.
It was a nice little run for Pat Brick, and maybe it's the start of a nice run for John. Yeah.
Yes, Jay, I'd like to say you use the keep it simple method of bowling. Right. Down and in, hit your target.
Yep.
What did you see out there today?
Well, 19's a little looser, but I got them both pretty well figured out. As long as my nerves stay, I'll be all right.
All right, well, I'm going to present you with this trophy, your second one. Congratulations. Right. Great bowling today.
All right, a guy who jumps out of plane said he had to deal with the nerves.
That's my dog.
Oh, not you, huh?
No, that's my fishing partner, my dog.
All right, well, I thought you did that with her, too. Maybe you're the smart one in the family then. All right, well, there we go. We got that cleared up, but I know one other thing that's cleared up. We're going to see John on next week's show. Sue and I will preview next week's stop here in Batavia when we return on Beat the Champ. Couple of great matches to finish out our week here in Batavia as Pat Brick comes up with a big win and then John Danielewicz comes up with a victory after that. Tight, nice, right down to the 10th frame. These are the kind of matches we love.
Yeah, we had great matches this week, honestly. That was as good a bowling as I've ever seen. And it came down to execution like we talked about. These bowlers made terrific shots and really were under a lot of pressure and came down to the 10th frame almost every time.
Janelle, could you feel it in the crowd, a little bit of the tension?
Yeah, you definitely could. I think I saw a couple people almost fall out of their seats there for a second. They were really hoping, and then some got what they want and some didn't.
Yeah, well, we know John Danielewicz got what he wants. He got the trophy from Sue, and he gets to come back next week. So we'll see how John does in our first match of next week's show. We're back for a couple of more weeks in Batavia. We will see you then. For the crew here at WBBZ, for Sue and for Janelle, my name is Paul Peck. Thanks for watching Beat the Champ.